very nice workshop. So I'm going to talk about work that I did at the end of my PhD with these people, Maciek and Remik, that were my supervisors at that time, Tony Afin, who is group leader at ICFO, and Ignacio and Gemma, that were at MPQ at that time. The paper, you can find it. Can find it there, and I have been told that this talk is recorded, and so you can also find this talk in YouTube. It's not the first time that I give it, and well, here you can find what can happen when you put your talk on YouTube. Luckily for us, the referee's comments were much more positive, and well, if Bob Luther is in the audience, I would be happy to discuss whatever he has to say. Okay. So I hope it has better reception. So this is the outline of what I'm going to tell you. I will first motivate the results and the question that we are investigating. Right, I will present what is the main idea and the setting, and then, well, for this talk, I will have to discuss two optimizations. One of them is quantum, the other is classical. And well, the connection is through assigning a Bell inequality to a physical Hamiltonian that I will also present. Then if you have some symmetries like translational invariants, then everything is much nicer. And depending on the time that I have left, I will discuss some examples and, well, conclusions and further outlook. Okay, so I think that many people in the audience may not be familiar with the so-called device-independent approach or non-locality, and well, I will just give, first of all, a general introduction to the field. And the way that I like to present this is that, well, if you think of quantum key distribution, maybe this is the most mature quantum technology at the moment. I mean, there are some companies, right? I mean, there was in Science last June the new record in this. Right, and if you look at why people claim that this is secure and so it's based on the theory, right? And the theory makes claims such as that you have a Hilbert space in which you have qubits, for instance. Right? Of course, if you go to the lab, I would not dare to call it C2, right? It's something that is much more complex. And, well, clearly there are some mismatches between theory and implementation. And, well, if you exploit the loopholes that appear in this mismatch, right, you will have someone that you can call quantum hacker, right? This is also a real picture. And, well, so it's in 2010, one of these commercial devices was hacked, right? And the reason was not that the theory was incorrect, right? The mathematics were fine, but of course, I mean, there is a leap that you have to cover, right? Well, then the new approach in the field was this so-called device-independent approach. So instead of looking at my laboratory with polarizers and beam splitters and things that are very difficult to characterize, I will just treat it as a black box, right? And this will have some knob in which I select some measurements to perform, and each measurement can give some output, right? So like the spin is +1 or -1, right? So it will have some outputs, and well, I will make measurements on this box, and I will get some statistics. So now the paradigm is a bit shifted, right? Because I'm interested, for instance, in what is the number of inputs and outputs of my box, right? And the question that I like to ask is whether the observed statistics are non-local, right? So if rather than, for instance, if my quantum state is entangled, right? This would be a question about Hilbert spaces. So if the statistics are non-local. Okay, so why consider Bell correlations, right, or non-local correlations? So they are a resource for the device-independent quantum information processing tasks, right? As I argued, if you make less assumptions, you have more security, right? You don't need to work with Hilbert spaces, right? And well, so these correlations have been actually measured in some remarkable experiments 2 years ago, right, in this so-called loophole-free Bell test. Of course, it's much more demanding to show non-locality than entanglement because you perform less assumptions, right, and therefore it's harder to show this, right? Also at MPQ where I work, there have been some experiments like this. Right, and with this you can do, well, device independent and whatever quantum information task from this list, right? Quantum key distribution, randomness expansion, amplification, self-testing, many things. The connection with entanglement is that Bell correlations are stronger than entanglement. So not all entangled states can display non-local correlations, but if you have non-local correlations, the only way to generate them is from an entangled state. Okay, and well, if you look at the literature, so most of the studies and applications of Bell correlations deal with small systems. And here we try to pose the question in a bit different way, right? So we were interested in seeing if these Bell correlations appear as a natural resource in low energy states of physical systems. Okay, so the rest of my talk is going to deal with many body states, right? And we want to see if these correlations appear naturally in their ground state, for instance. Right, this is a less studied problem because of the mathematical complexity that you have. It's also more experimentally demanding because you may need to measure more particles. And so you have a question? Okay. And well, you know that the quantum description of multipartite states grows exponentially with the system size, right? So you also have to overcome these difficulties. Right. In previous works, we dealt with permutational invariant systems, right, and this had been shown in some experiments of hundreds of thousands of atoms in a thermal state of a B or on a BEC. Right, so there has been some progress in that. And in this talk, I will focus on spin systems in one spatial dimension. Okay, so not permutational invariant, but you have to think of 1D systems. Okay, I will spend one slide on defining what is non-locality, and so just to follow more easily the talk. So you have several players, right? Alice, Bob, Charlie, and so on. And each of them has their own black box, so this would be their laboratory. And they have some inputs, X1, X2, X3, right? And this is the measurement that they choose to perform. They don't know what's exactly happening inside the box, right? But they read out the measurement, right? So classical information goes in and classical information goes out, right? And at the end of the day, they repeat this many, many, many times, and they can estimate these conditional probabilities of the outputs given the inputs, right? And you can collect this this huge table of numbers in a vector, and this you can represent in a point in some geometrical space. So now the question is that, well, depending on the assumptions that you make on the physical theory in which this experiment is carried, right, there is a feasibility region according to your physical theory. So if you have a local hidden variable model, right, this region looks cartoon picture like that, so it's a polytope, right, so it has flat faces and a finite number of vertices. And, well, Bell showed that the correlations that arise from quantum theory are actually larger than this set. Okay? And you can also consider more general physical principles like the no signaling principle and so on, right? So the operational way to interpret this set is, so the LHV set, right? The set of classical correlations, well, local hidden variable model, is that the vertices are very special in this set. So they correspond to when everything that happens inside of each of these boxes is a deterministic program. Okay, so given the input, the outcome is determined and only by the input of the same box, right? And then, well, these players could have agreed in the past to follow some strategy, right? This would be like analogous to the hidden variable. And here I have made an example, right? So if I call lambda my hidden variable, right? Alice, Bob, and Charlie could have agreed on some probability distribution on lambda in the past. And they say, okay, when the value of the hidden variable is 1, we're going to do something, right? And then when it's 3, we're going to do some other thing. And in this way, you see that you mix different vertices, right? And then you can access any point inside of this region. Okay, then a Bell inequality is simply a half space that contains the local polytope. Okay, so geometrically, you can think of Bell inequalities like that, facets of this object. Okay, so let's go to the idea of our result. Right, so we would like to start with a Hamiltonian, right, and from this Hamiltonian, we assume that we know how to compute its ground state energy, or at least to prepare a state of sufficiently low energy. Right, I will illustrate that with Jordan Bigner or some numerical methods. So these are all known tools to achieve this result. And we will establish an equivalence from this Hamiltonian to so-called Bell operator. Right? The Bell operator is when you have a Bell inequality, you put quantum measurements in it, then you have an object that is in a Hilbert space, right? And then you can very easily identify that with a Hamiltonian. Right, and then, well, you perform measurements on your system, and you get some expectation values. So this is the quantum value. Right, and then we will connect that to the Bell inequality. So it means that, Hamiltonian or a Bell operator, if you choose the inequality coefficients appropriately, then you get some inequality, but it also works the other way. Right, so from Bell inequality, if you make suitable observables, suitable measurements on it, then you generate different kinds of Bell operators or Hamiltonians. Right. So these Bell inequalities, what's important about them is their classical bound, right? So the limit that they can achieve within the local hidden variable model theory. With this, I will use a technique that is kind of underused, I would say, in the field of quantum information, but it's very general and maybe used in many ways. And finally, by comparing these two values, you would see if you have Bell correlations. So, namely, if you violate this Bell inequality. If you, on top of that, you have some symmetry like translational invariance, and everything is much nicer, right? For this side, we will have analytical expressions, and for the other, we will have an exponential speed up in the way to compute this classical bound. Okay, so to fix the setting, I will consider spin 1/2 Hamiltonians and particles in one spatial dimension. If they have open or periodic boundary conditions, it's not so important, so you can think of either of them. What is important is that their interaction range is short, right? So I will call that capital R, and you have to think of this as a constant, right? The system size is variable, but this R has to be a constant. So it could be a Hamiltonian that has this form, right? So for instance, some sigma z's, right? And then some string operators like some x, some z's in the middle, and some x or y at the end. Why do I put such a particular form of a Hamiltonian is that, because this, I know how to compute the ground state energy easily and analytically, but the method is not restricted to that, as I will illustrate in the end of the talk, but I think that it may be, some people may be familiar here with the Jordan Bigner transformation, that is how you solve these kind of systems, and then it's easier to follow. This is also XY model in a transverse magnetic field would be a particular case of this Hamiltonian. Okay, so how do you find the ground state energy? So in this case, you can do exact diagonalization. And well, there is a mathematical trick that maps a spin Hamiltonian to a fermion Hamiltonian, right? So this CI0 and CI1 are Majorana fermions, so they obey some canonical anti-commutation relationship. Right, and then every Hamiltonian of this previous form that I showed becomes quadratic, and this is the key point to find the ground state energy in this way. After you make all the substitutions, right, you find that you have a Hamiltonian of this form that is quadratic in terms of fermions. This matrix of coefficients is also real and antisymmetric, and you can exploit these properties because real antisymmetric matrices they admit what is called a Williamson eigen decomposition. So it means that there is an orthogonal matrix that almost diagonalizes them. Right? You have these 2 × 2 blocks, and it's block diagonal. And then, well, this actually means that you have a new family of Majorana fermions. And finally, your Hamiltonian looks like that. So a sum of n terms, right? And each of these operators mutually commutes. So this means that you could recover the spectrum of your Hamiltonian from these numbers, right? The eigenvalues of these operators are plus minus one. So you see that to find the ground state energy is very easy because you just have to take these numbers with plus one eigenvalue for this and with minus one for the rest. Right. There are some subtleties that are like parity in positive superselection rule, but I'm not going to go into these details. The point here is that you can compute that very efficiently with the system size, because you see that this is not exponential in n, it's just linear. Okay, so now we have to assign a very inequality to the Hamiltonian to ask what is the non-locality of its lower energy states. And well, the key is that we want a Bell operator that resembles as much as possible as the original Hamiltonian, otherwise it's no use to find this ground state energy. Right, so we want something that is just a Hamiltonian but shifted by a value. So to go from a Bell inequality to a Bell operator, you have to choose some measurements. Right, so it means that in the Bloch sphere, Alice has to do some measurements, and now it's the moment that you have to choose them. And the most general thing that you can do here is to take measurements in the XY plane and one measurement in the Z direction, and then you can, making many measurements here in this plane, and another one in the Z direction, you can actually obtain Bell operators that have this form. Right? And then the Bell inequality looks like that, right? You would have one. Okay, so if you have a string operator here, you have to measure a many-body correlator. If you have a one-body operator here, one-body correlator, and so on. Okay, but now, if you know how to compute the classical bound of this inequality, then you can hope to answer the question. Okay, so how do you compute the classical bound of the inequality? Okay, so the inequality, I will write it in this form, I plus the classical bound greater equal than zero. So if the expectation value of this is negative, it will be violated and there will be non-local correlations. And well, this is the definition, right? The optimum over all the local hidden variable models of the inequality, right? So geometrically it means that I have a hyperplane in some direction in this space and I just have to push it up to the edge of this set, right? This is the optimization. So Fine's theorem, this is an old result, tells you that this is it's enough to optimize over local deterministic strategies, right, over the vertices. And well, so how many local deterministic strategies do you have in a many body system? Well, this depends on how many measurements the parties can perform, right? So for instance, if you can perform three measurements, and on the number of parties that you have, right, Alice, Bob, and so on. So you could say, okay, the deterministic outcome for the first measurement of Alice is going to be black or plus one or whatever, right? And then for the other two, it could be like this, right? And then you fill this table, right? And this is the description of one of these vertices. So you see that this is very bad news because, well, you have a number of vertices that is exponential in the system size, right? Also in the number of measurements. But, our Bell inequalities actually are built of are in a kind of 1D geometry, right? They contain short-range interaction terms, right? So it means like low-order correlators, and we are not exploiting this at all, right? So with this technique, dynamic programming, you can actually find this efficiently. Okay, so this optimization that you would do with linear programming in the general case, and you have to put as many constraints as vertices, so it's impossible for many body inequalities. It's actually doable and extremely efficient for 1D. So to apply this dynamic programming, you need some ingredients like a recurrence relation. You need to be able to compute and store intermediate subsolutions and you order them, right? This is just a very abstract way of defining it, right? And because it's a very general technique. And well, you get normally a polynomial scaling and a constructive method of one of these vertices, right? And so it's much better than the brute force approach, right? And well, to convince you that this is a very general technique, right? If you go to this website, they make coding competitions, and if you look at the kind of problems that they put and the technique that you use to solve them, right? Dynamic programming is the third, which is quite remarkable, right? So it's something that, well, I think that's useful beyond this talk. Okay, so for this particular case, so we want to express the Bell inequality as a sum of smaller ones, right? And then the optimization is, well, you have some subsolution at some point, right? So you have filled part of the local deterministic strategy that is optimal, right? And well, you have something beyond that you really don't care because you want to optimize this part in the middle. And the inequality is made of short-range interaction terms, right? So whatever you put here will not affect what the solution is going to look like afterwards, right? So I did not put the actual formula. I think that pictorically this is easier to follow, right? So you would like to, at each, there will be n steps, right? At each step you would optimize these squares. They may depend on something that is a little bit beyond because the inequality is short range, right? But not on more things, right? So you have a recurrence relation and you define this by, well, seeing what are the, all the possible values here of these triangles. Because this is a finite number of values, you can compute all of them, and then you have this recurrence well-defined, right? And then you find a classical bound as the end product of this optimization. Okay. So here, what I think it's non-trivial is that the overall complexity of this is linear, whereas in the general case, this would be exponential in the number of parties, right? So you have an exponential speed-up in computing this value. So if you have translational invariance, now things become much more nice. So in the case of the classical bound, you would have here the same link everywhere. So it means that, pictorially, I think that it's better that I describe the figure, right? So you would have several sites with n parties, right? And then you can define a function that depends on, that would allow you to remove the even sites, right? So you would say f of x and y would be the minimum over z, that is the one that is in color, of that link plus that link, right? And then this is a well-defined function if you compute it for every x and y, which can take a finite amount of values, and then you can go to the next row, right? And then you keep repeating that, right? And then you achieve exponential speed up because you remove half of the parties every time. And, well, not everything is a power of two in life, but then you can apply just the previous scheme, but you only have a logarithmic number of terms left, right? So you compute in log n steps the classical bound, right? So it's a doubly exponential gain with respect to the most general case. Okay. Well, if the R is greater than one, you can also do it. It's a bit more tricky. I don't have time to explain that. Okay. So in the quantum case, this H matrix of coefficients has the additional property that it's block circulant, right? And then you can hope to find the ground state energy analytically, even. You don't have to run any numerics. And the thing is that block circulant matrices are diagonalized with a discrete Fourier transform, right? So this orthogonal matrix that was diagonalizing H in the general case. Now you know which one it is, right? And then, okay, depending on the parity of the system, you have to do a couple of fixes, but both of them work, right? So you have a matrix that its elements would look like this, right? So it would be the same element on every diagonal. And then, well, okay, long story short, means that you have an analytical solution for the epsilons, right? That would be the Williamson eigenvalues. Okay, so you put all these formulas here inside of this, and then you can compute analytically what is the ground state energy. Okay, so maybe I illustrate that with an example. I think that, maybe the most interesting one, I put many of them, but I would like... Okay, so if we consider XXZ model and an inequality in quantum information that is called Gizan's, he calls it elegant inequality, the inequality looks like this. So you have two parties, Alice and Bob, right? And you have this kind of coefficients defining the inequality. So Alice has four measurements, Bob has three measurements, right? And then here I added this delta to then make the mapping to the XXZ model. Right, and Alice and Bob perform the measurements in these directions in the block sphere, so they are quite symmetric, right? But the point is that the Bell operator, when you perform these optimal measurements for Gizan's inequality, it looks like this, right? So sigma x plus sigma y plus this delta, so this is why I added it, sigma z, okay, so this is very close to the XXZ model, right? If I would make a sum of these inequalities, right, I would have actually something that would be exactly the XXZ model. So here you see that the equivalence between the Bell inequality and the Hamiltonian is can be non-obvious, because here we have a Bell operator that is permutational invariant. If I exchange Alice and Bob, nothing changes. But the Bell inequality is not even not symmetric in any way, right? Because I mean, not even it has the same number of measurements at each site, right? So, but well, nevertheless, we found this correspondence, and then well, you can build up a toy model like using this Gisson's inequality here at these links with these weights. You can add an epsilon parameter, right? So some weights are stronger than others. And then you have that the classical bound looks like, well, you can find it analytically, and it have kind of phase diagram, I would say, but this is for the classical bound, right? So depending on the epsilon and the delta that you put in the inequality, right? You have, well, several values, so several kind of inequalities depending on the parameter region that you have. So now, how do you compute the ground state energy of this Hamiltonian? So in this case, you cannot use the Jordan-Winger transformation because this would not work in this model, but you can run some numerics on it. Okay? So this would be the Hamiltonian that I am interested in studying. Right, so it's similar to an XXZ model. So if you use matrix product states or DMRG or, well, any tensor network method, so here we used this one, you have a result that looks like this, right? So this corresponds to a different number of parties. This will be the parameters that you put in the model and the inequality, right? So it's delta and epsilon. And you see that there is a region in the middle that is non-local, right? So for any value of these parameters, well, the ground state energy of this Hamiltonian has Bell correlations. Okay, so you can certify, for instance, that the ground state is entangled even without knowing what state that you have prepared, right? And without making assumptions on, for instance, if it's formed of qubits, right, or what measurements you are actually performing on the state. And this seems to be robust as n grows, right, because you see that this region, that, well, doesn't seem to shrink. This is just an example. You can do it with many other Bell inequalities, right, but I have skipped them in the interest of time. So let me go to the conclusions and, well, so to apply this method, if you want to show non-locality in a many-body system, basically what you would need to do is to solve three problems at the same time, right? The first is that you should be able to solve efficiently the combinatorial optimization to find the classical bound, right? And for this, I briefly explained that you can do it with dynamic programming. But if you find another technique that is efficient, this would also work. Then you have to show that the inequality is actually non-trivial, so that quantum physics can violate the value of this inequality. Otherwise, you are not going to show anything, right? So in our case, because we have made this correspondence between the inequality and the Hamiltonian, this is reduced to finding the ground state energy of the Hamiltonian or a sufficiently low energy, right? It doesn't need to be the ground state. And you can do it, well, for some models exactly with the Jordan-Winger transformation, but for more general models, you can do it numerically, and that's fine. And then, on top of that, you would want to make it experimentally accessible, right? So if you have to show this non-locality by making many measurements or very complicated measurements that require single particle addressing, or they are very difficult to do in the lab, then nobody could actually do it, right? So here, we think that it's advantageous that with a few body correlators or two-body, right, you can actually measure the ground state energy because you have your Hamiltonian is a sum of local terms, right? But well, you can also use other methods to estimate the ground state energy, right? If you have a quantum computer, you do phase estimation, for instance. But it depends on if you are happy with this hypothesis. Then, if you have a symmetry that is natural to the system, so we have here discussed 1D system, so it's natural to consider translational invariants. Well, in the quantum case, we have closed formulas, and in the In the classical case, we have exponential speed improvement, right? So this is a tool set that allows you to study non-locality in physically relevant systems, right? So you need spin systems, one spatial dimension, and short-range interactions. And here, short-range interactions, it's, I think it's funny because this is what limits mostly the classical optimization, that not the quantum one, right? Or at least, well, for some Hamiltonians. So let me discuss further research directions that one could take from here. So we started studying this because, well, contrary to the permutationally invariant case, there is no definite restriction. So we thought that the inequalities would be more robust, right? So if you have a permutational invariant operator or a permutational invariant state, then you know that if you look at the reduced states of its subsystem, all of them are equal because it's permutationally invariant, but they go to a separable state with some speed with the system size. This is what the definite tells you. This doesn't happen in 1D systems, and well, this makes this more robust in this sense. So in this work, I have presented that you can see the Hamiltonian as a particular realization of a Bell inequality. Right, I have skipped the details, but I hope that this idea is clear. But one can also put the problem in a different way, right? So now you give me a Hamiltonian, and I will try to find what is the inequality that best reveals the non-local properties of its low-energy spectrum, right? Because so the ground state energy of the Hamiltonian, I need to find it only once, or the energy of the system, I need to measure it only once. But if I change the Bell inequality, if I make sure that also changing the measurements, I keep getting the same Hamiltonian, I only have to do the classical optimization, right? And this I can do, not in the lab, right? In the fully translational invariant case, so there is a phenomenon that is called monogamy of correlations. Sorry. It's still unclear to us how this affects non-locality. So monogamy of correlations is like similar to monogamy of entanglement. So if you have three parties, Alice, Bob, and Charlie, and they measure, for instance, a Bell inequality between Alice and Bob, and the same between Alice and Charlie, you would see that, for instance, the most basic one, CHSH, if Alice and Bob violate the Bell inequality, Alice and Charlie cannot violate it at the same time. Right, so there is some constraint that affects this when you make a many-body system. And we have been thinking also how to generalize this to more spatial dimensions, and well, there are some tools about chordal extensions and semi-definite programming that if you want, we can discuss later. And then also I think that one of the referees pointed out a very interesting question, that is to study the persistence of non-locality, right? So what happens if you miss some of the parties from your system, right? If you trace out some parties from your system, can you still show these results, or they are not robust to particle losses, right? So for instance, if you had a state like GHZ, you know that if you lose one qubit, then this is indistinguishable from a classical mixture, right? So how robust are these inequalities to this kind of phenomenon? So with this, I would like to finish, and thank you very much for your attention.